Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Total Biscuit. I'm here to ask and answer one simple question. WTF is Endless Space? Endless Space is a 4X turn-based, space-based strategy game. That's a bit of a long name, isn't it? It's by a company called Amplitude, as you can very clearly see here. Notice a lot of people with very long names. I really like that. Creative director Romain de Wubert Degenlis, I assume. I don't even know. I'm murdering his name here. These guys are actually a French studio. So what is it all about? It's about conquering the universe in the style of games such as the one and only Master of Orion, as well as Pax Imperia, Galciv, a few other games like that. For a long time, we had a drought of these kind of things, and the only thing keeping us going was Galciv and the Space Empires series. Unfortunately, Space Empires 5 didn't really get the kind of gameplay that I was looking for. I don't even view it as an improvement on Space Empires 4, honestly. That seems to be the way. Whenever you make a series like this, eventually, something will go horribly wrong because there's this really crazy balance you've got to strike between micromanagement and macromanagement. The change between Master of Orion 2 and 3 is the biggest example of this. What happened with Master of Orion 2 is that game was a classic. Yeah, it is a classic. Loads of people love that game. It essentially defined the entire space-based 4X genre. Then what they did was they looked at the complaints from Master of Orion 2 and said, oh, well, what can we do? Well, the complaints, cartoony graphic style, too much micromanagement and battles. And they actually took those two complaints and they turned the game into something really boring with Master of Orion 3. They took away the micromanagement across the board to the point where the game essentially played itself. The battles were incredibly boring. The interface was really, really dull. It lacked any semblance of character, which Master of Orion 2 had in spades. The question is, does Endless Space actually match up to that? Let's load a game and find out. This is not the kind of game you can do a first impressions on. It's a very in-depth strategy game. So while I was away in San Diego, I decided I'm going to play a game through, and I restarted my game about 4 or 5 times, and eventually got to turn 147 with the Sophon race. So let's take a look and see what it's all about then, shall we? Okay, welcome to Endless Space, which is supposedly endless, but I have a feeling there is an end somewhere if we're to look far enough. And it looks like we're going to get immediately into a battle. This is not going to go well for you. No, this is not going to go well. This is a perfect opportunity to demonstrate the battle system, I guess, because I'm immediately going to be engaging against this guy. He has one small fleet of one ship. I have these dudes who are going to kick your ass. There's no question about that. Screw it, let's fire the unnecessarily large warheads. Yeah, you are so dead, it's not even funny. So horribly dead. Well, this is not going to go well for you, in my opinion. I activated the dust warheads. These actually cost me currency to fire, just because I thought the only good kill is overkill. And here it comes. That ship's about to melt. The automatic camera should hopefully zoom in at the right time. It actually used camouflage to reduce the amount of damage that was coming in. Did it help? No, not at all. Immediately annihilated. So I didn't really do much in that battle, did I? No, that's because the battle system is primarily a cinematic experience. There are some cards that you can play. You saw them come up on the screen when I went to the long range phase. There are 3 phases in combat: long range, medium, and short. At long range, missiles are most effective. Medium range, lasers are most effective. At short range, kinetic weapons such as mass drivers and railguns are most effective. At each of these phases, you can pick a card. You have to do that before the phase begins. And there's this kind of rock, paper, scissors thing going on, but it's not as hard countery as you might think. There are some cards that directly counter others and give you an advantage, but it doesn't mean you automatically win. It just gives you an edge. If you've still got better ships and better technology, you can survive. It also depends on what kind of defenses you've got. If you're up against guys that have really loaded out on missiles, then you can use a tactic which allows you to reduce the amount of damage coming in from missiles. And if you've got a lot of missile defense, basically flat cannons, then you can absorb a lot of that damage and hopefully not die in that phase. So it isn't really as rock, paper, scissors as you might imagine, but it does really come down to tailoring your fleet to destroy whatever it is you're facing up against. Okay, well, now that we're done with that, you'll notice this game is, of course, in turn-based, so we don't really have to worry too much about that. This is my empire in the pink here. This is the remains of the United Empire who are being wiped out slowly but surely by me, I think, from one side, and these dudes from the other. These guys scare me a little bit, honestly. I don't really want to fight them. And then I think these are the amoebas. Yeah, the amoeba empire is quite small and over in this direction. The cool thing is I actually have access to all this area of space. No one can get there without passing through my space and getting intercepted. So by holding these two systems here, I actually have access to a lot of resources that I could potentially exploit on these six planets over here. All of the other stuff over to this side has actually been colonized. I think we've discovered everything that this map has to offer. The map is quite small at the moment because I'm just playing a four-player game. It can, of course, go much, much larger than that. Now, when it comes to 4X strategy games, you've got to worry about a few different things. I always forget what these are. So, what does X stand for? Why is it called a 4X? Well, it's a weird marketing term that was coined a long time ago. And I believe it was actually coined by Sid Meier when it comes to his game Civilization. That was a 4X game. Can I remember all the X's? I never can. Explore, exploit, exterminate, and something else which I can't quite remember. Could be extend. I don't even know. I always forget this. Always. It's EX, though. It's EX all the time. But what it means is it's about expanding your empire, gaining new technologies, fighting other dudes, and essentially conquering whatever it is via a variety of different ways to win. Victory conditions, as they're called. This game also has victory conditions. In this case, I'm fighting off a lot of these guys. There's an enemy fleet coming in this direction. Not very powerful, though. In fact, I actually have a fleet on standby ready to intercept that. I would not recommend going anywhere near that. That's a tiny little one frigate fleet. This is a fairly heavy fleet containing two large battle cruisers and three of my top-end support frigates. Now, I actually designed these ships. Let me show you what the ship design's all about in this particular game. So if I head on over to the fleet screen, you'll notice my available ship designs as well as a list of my current fleets. What this game does very well is give you the ability to see at a glance what you've got in your empire. It's kind of spreadsheet-y, actually, and we'll talk more about the interface in a minute. So let's design a ship. These are my current ships. I'm going to add a new ship design here. So, these are the classes of ship that I currently have available based on what I've researched. I believe there's a bigger ship than this. This is kind of like a battleship. Smaller ships right here. The cosmetic elements, the actual design of the ship from an aesthetic standpoint, that's all changed depending on which race you pick. I quite like these guys. Like these in particular, very cool, sleek-looking vessels. Reminded me very much of a Protoss carrier there. So I was a fan of these guys. I also like the bonuses that the Empire happened to give me. So if I wanted to design one of these, a Yotter class, which is the biggest one that I've currently got, then I would go first through my weapons modules. So there's three different kinds of weapons in this game, and that actually disappoints me somewhat because, really, this is actually kind of dull. The three different kinds of weapons, well, these are just generic upgrades. Like, why would I pick anything else? These are clearly more powerful. They fire more projectiles, they do more damage. They're just flat out better. There was no choice here at all. The only reason you choose smaller modules, and bear in mind they all have a weight, and the mass of the module, actually, the difference here is tiny. I mean, look at the difference between that. It's only one mass different, based on the research that I've currently got, and yet the railgun is an infinitely more effective weapon. By infinitely, of course, I mean marginally more effective weapon. Let's misuse words to upset people in the comments section. Whatever the case, why would I not pick the best? In this case, I haven't put a lot of research into beam weapons. I've not really been too concerned about that. I do have some fairly powerful torpedoes, and I've got some really powerful kinetic weapons. I could design a ship that has nothing but missiles if I wanted to be kind of a strike cruiser that destroyed the enemy before they could actually get in close. Which means I could also then, as a result, minimize, if I want to take a risk, of course, minimize the kind of shielding I've got. Like layered hulls, for instance, these are deflectors. These are designed to deflect kinetic attacks. So at long range, this isn't a big deal. If I think I can wipe out an entire enemy fleet before it gets close, I could just skip these entirely. What I would have to deal with, of course, is the fact that I've got incoming missiles, so I'd maybe have to throw on some dense plasma shields, essentially flak defense modules, and then maybe some energy shields in order to deflect energy weapons that were being shot in my general direction. Support-wise, I want to put a smart module on here to give me more tonnage. This is going to, of course, increase the cost of it, and it also requires a special resource, Hexaferrum. Depending on what I've got in my empire, depends on whether or not I can actually use this. If I don't have access to Hexaferrum, then I can't build these kind of ships. This also makes it at least somewhat viable at least when you're dealing with smaller empires, to actually deny resources to various different factions. You can also trade special resources, but once your empire gets sufficiently large, chances are you're going to have so many sources of the various different kinds of tactical and strategic resources on the field that you really don't care. Could add some adaptive glue. This is where things get interesting. This is what I kind of like. So some of these modules actually are something of a choice. Now, these ones, this is just a case of more tonnage, more cost, it's better. But these not so much. If I look at these repair modules here, you'll notice that they actually have different values. So in this case, the smart wrenches gives me plus flat fleet HP on both my ship and on all of the ships in my sector. This one's pretty good at that too. This is actually a special module. If I recall correctly, this might even be unique to this race. There are certain researchers and modules which are unique to each race. Whatever the case, this one is flat out better than that one. But this one, well, that's a different matter entirely because this is percentage based. So in reality, if I've got a fleet of large battleships, I'll want intelligent tools rather than smart glue. Smart glue is much more effective on a fleet of smaller ships with less HP because it upgrades flat rather than percentage. Aside from that, you can put other support modules on, like there's a difference between these two. I can only pick one of them. I can increase the maximum damage of my weapons. This one will increase the maximum damage that I can actually take coming in my direction. There's also invasion. Invasion is a possibility. Once again, there's a little bit of a difference here. That's also got a percentile base kind of thing, so some of these are more effective on smaller ships. And then once I've kind of thrown the design together, or I could just automatically have it make it, I could try and have it make the best ship based on the stuff that I've picked by clicking auto upgrade. So you see there, 15 racks of fusion torpedoes, 10 railguns, 11 dense plasma shields, and a partridge and a pear tree. And then once I'm done with that, stick in a ship name, the La-di-dar class attack cruiser, and then create. After that, it's just a case of building them. You can also upgrade designs. So let's actually see if I can. I think these guys, these are like Mark V medium cruisers that I designed. These are probably using the best technology I've got available to me. But we can check. If I click auto upgrade, as you can see, it actually can do a little bit there. So it's made some slight changes to my design. Actually, never mind. No, it hasn't. It's just rearranged things because it thinks it looks neater. Usually you'll be able to apply there, it'll upgrade the mark of your ships, and then you can pay resources in order to upgrade your existing fleet, and it actually does that instantly, which is interesting. That's not usual in games like this. Alright, now let's talk about the interface. So, I both like and dislike the interface. I like the interface because of how clean it is, and I dislike the interface because of how clean it is. You're like, what? What are you talking about? This actually makes more sense than you might think. So, the problem with having an interface like this is that it's really, really clinical. Yeah? It shows me everything I want very effectively, but in terms of its actual design, it doesn't look very interesting. Now, for a lot of people, that isn't important. They just want the interface to be clean and to give them all of their information, so that's great. Some other people may be put off by this. I really do like the star system screens here because they've got a ton of detail. They look gorgeous. I mean, look at that. You can then zoom into the planet, see what's going on there. I would like to see maybe some more changes to the planet based on what's built on it. That's something you don't really have. So in this game, you've got something called planetary exploitation. You can essentially pick one of four different things to focus your planet on. Aside from that, all of the stuff that's going on in the system, all of these improvements, they're actually system-wide. So you'll see I've built all of these improvements. I have an infinite supermarket. This game does have an interesting sense of humor at times. The infinite supermarket makes people a hell of a lot happier. I have Sysort satellites, which give me area influence. I have epigenetic crop seeding. I've got all sorts of different things on this system. All of these are system-wide and have system-wide benefits. The individual planets, they have a couple of characteristics you need to understand. The first, of course, is the exploitation. So I have no exploitation on this map. So which one do I want to go for? Well, it depends what I really want from the system. This system isn't making me a lot of money. It's actually a bit of drain on money at the moment because of the amount of improvements I've got. So maybe I want to increase that. I'm also looking at industry here. Industry production is pretty good. My food supplies are pretty good. My approval's terrible because I think I actually took this system over quite recently, so they really, really hate me. Good research. I think I want to make some more money. So if I build a temporal finance, which is an interesting upgrade to say the least. It's about financing with different realities and stuff like that. It's kind of crazy. If I click that, that's going to improve that, and eventually, hopefully this will make me some more money. I could also survey the moon that's surrounding this area, because it might contain something useful. I may also be able to terraform it. I could terraform this lava planet into a baron, and then maybe with the right technology I could terraform the baron into something else. So there are various different kinds of planets. Lava planets are, needless to say, quite difficult to actually colonize. You need a lot of technology to be able to do that. And also, they make people hate you. What I really like about this is that every single kind of world has a bunch of different characteristics. Like, a large lava planet is actually different to a small lava planet in terms, of course, of the amount of people you can fit on it. Lava versus tundra, notice the amount of statistics there. Like, people are less happy on a lava planet than they are on a tundra planet. But bear in mind that a lava planet is much better for production. Every population unit I have gives me 4 extra production here, so that's pretty cool. There are also phenomenon on planets. Some are really bad. Like, I actually had this one removed. It even changed the description. This is the coolest thing. I had the phenomenon removed, and it changed the description for me. I mean, what a damn cool thing is that? What a awesome idea. That's a hell of a lot of detail that's been put in there. So this planet used to have really bad meteor strikes, but I was able to get technology to fix that, and now it's actually good, because we get a bunch of free resources from it. Speaking of resources, there are also some strategic resources here. Hyperium is available on this planet, and I can exploit that, and it will become part of my empire. And this will give me effects. If I have a certain number of it, then I'll get a bonus. It's called resource abundance, and in the case of luxury resource, you can see at the top all of the stuff that I have available to me over the course of my empire. If I have a monopoly on this, I gain like 20% approval over the entire empire. That's a huge deal. That is so, so very useful. Protowalk, it's right there. I actually get plus 10% production on everything throughout the empire. That's huge. So getting a monopoly of resources is vastly important in this particular game. But I just love that amount of detail. I really do. They've gone super in-depth with that. And I think that this is a game designed for min-maxers. Now, this also comes onto a point that I don't necessarily like. But I have this internal conflict going on. Because, to me, I am kind of a min-maxer. But there are degrees of what I will tolerate. I think maybe this game does a little bit too much of that. In the first, say, 50 turns of this game, all I was really doing was trying to deal with my planets and trying to get them all balanced up in the way that I want. Say, resource-wise. Like, right now, this place is, like, churning out loads and loads of science, as you can see. This is my big science system. I've even got a hero here who can actually increase the amount of scientific discovery that's going on and increase the amount of money that this place makes via trade routes. I'll talk about heroes in a minute. But I spent a lot of time early on trying to balance things out. I had to restart the game a few times because I overexpanded in a system. You can colonize each individual planet, but it takes population from one to go to the other. And what ended up happening was I spread my population too thinly. I couldn't make enough money, I couldn't make enough food, and my guys started starving. And then, being dumbasses that they are, because they got upset because of starving, they went and stole more food, which made them starve more. It's like, what? What's wrong with you guys? The logic, it simply is not there. But I think the people that really dislike this balancing act that you have to play are going to absolutely hate it, because there is quite a lot of micromanagement in there. However, fear not, folks. If you don't like that kind of stuff, look at the size of my empire. That's pretty significant. Oh god, oh god. Panic, panic, panic. No, not really, because you can also apply an AI, and you can apply various kinds of AI to the system. So if I want an AI that is focused purely on building stuff that improves the happiness of the people in that system, maybe that's a big deal, and actually it kind of is. As you can see, Cygnus is having some problems right now. It's actually on strike, so I might want to change the AI over to focusing on approval stuff. So hopefully the computer will be able to fix this for me. In this case, I'm keeping my main production hub, which is the one that has the most industrial potential, as something which doesn't have AI here, because this is my main shipyard. This is where most of my ships will be built. The cool thing is as well that from this interface, I can also actually build whatever I want. So I've wanted to build a la-di-da, which I don't see why I would, because it's not properly balanced in comparison to my other stuff. But let's just say we're building a la-di-da class attack cruiser. Just click it from there, done. Nice and easy. Right-click out. So controlling an empire is kind of made super simple if you use the automation tools that are at your disposal here. Now, hero system. So you can hire heroes which gradually level up. This guy is my main fleet admiral. This guy is responsible for doing all sorts of great stuff, and as a result, he's unlocked a huge amount of different abilities. And look at that. He buffs the fleet up so very well. The thing is, you can't have a lot of heroes. At the moment, I can only have 3. I think you can improve that with research, but I can only have 3. You can also have heroes that run star systems. This guy over here, for instance. This guy is all about making people happy. No one screws around when this guy is actually running a star system. He is directly responsible for that. He's actually on System Centaurus. We can go there and we'll show his benefits. Look at that. This is System Centaurus. So he is producing a huge amount of food. Approval rate is at 100%. This system is an economic powerhouse that has more food than you can possibly ever need. As a result, it's rapidly populating and increases the population speed due to the overabundance of food. So this system is doing really well for itself as a result of this guy. But of course, you can't have that many. So I could move this guy around if I'm having a problem on this system. Maybe I want to move him to Itta, for instance. That's probably going to fix a lot of problems there. In fact, I might even want to consider doing that. Canis is on strike right now. I think that's another one that I actually ended up taking from the enemy. So they're really not very happy with me. It's good stuff. All of this is good stuff. But... there are some problems that I have with the game. Notice I haven't even taken the turn. I'll probably do a little bit more combat to show you how that goes. There's going to be a fight here. What's the size of my fleet there? Oh yeah, you're gonna get wrecked. You're going to get wrecked. In fact, I'm just going to attack him right now and get him out of the system. He has 3 ships there. It's a little bit more powerful than he used to, but yeah, I think he's going to get destroyed. This is my Admiral's fleet. He is not messing around. He has got some extremely powerful ships. He's got my highest end cruisers, at least medium cruisers anyway. So yeah, we're going to wreck some stuff. Now, I don't really want to lose anything, so you know what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to use the ultimate defense card, which is something that my Admiral gives me. This is just 25% efficiency on all defense modules across the board, because I know I'm going to win this fight, but I don't want to lose a ship accidentally or actually take any real damage. So I want to upgrade what's coming in. Right, they've got a bunch of missiles firing in my general direction. If I want, I can actually switch to free cam, so I can just move around the area and zoom in on what I please. The ship designs and the texture work is really nice. That is blatantly inspired by Battlefleet Gothic. There's no question about that, and I'm glad that it is, because it looks gorgeous. Here come the missiles, and there's no way in a million years you're getting through that. There we go. 2 of their ships immediately wiped out. I'm actually not even using an ability at this point, which gives him an advantage, because if you're not using an ability, then your ships just don't work as well. He's using tactics and adaptive strategy, so there's probably not going to be enough missiles, I would think, to actually go through the defenses of my ships. I would be very, very surprised if there was. I actually do like the auto camera, because it kind of moves around in a really cool way that reminds me of Battlestar Galactica. But you can get some really nice sweeping views of the ships as they pass there. Unfortunately, the battle system doesn't really have a lot of depth to it, in my opinion. It's probably one of the weakest points in this particular game. And if you're looking for tactical battles, you're not getting them from this game at all. Absolutely not. Very little thought involved. What should I get? Lethal Modder. Tinkerer. Let's get Tinkerer 2. There we go. That's going to give me yet more stats. These stats here directly affect how my fleet actually operates. As you can see right there. Yeah, he ain't messing around. There's really nothing that the Blue Empire can actually throw at me at this point, which will cause me any problems. Now, another thing I don't really like is the invasion system. So, it is possible to invade a planet, which is exactly what I'm doing right now. I'm invading this. I want to take this system over. But there's nothing to it. Like, you invade, there's some under-the-hood stuff that happens. It doesn't show you anything. The only visual indicator of how well your invasion's going is this little circle here. Once you fill up, you take it. There's nothing to it at all. You can customize your ships to be better at invasions, but there's no ground combat. Like, I remember the ground combat in Master of Orion. There was nothing to that either, but at least you got to see it, you know? You even got to see the upgrades. If you had mechs and things like that, then it would actually show those on this little cartoon battlefield. That would be sweet. But they don't have that either. I think the whole game rubs me in such a way, yes, kinky, rubs me in such a way that I think everything's so impersonal. Master of Orion had real character to it. This game does not. It really, really doesn't. I wish that I could say otherwise. I genuinely do, but it does try to be funny every now and again, and how it has a reasonable sense of humor, but it's just the nature of the game and the interface and the way you interact with the different races. It just makes things kind of super dull at times. I played through and I, for the most part, enjoyed my time with it, but at every point I was hoping for something to happen in the game that just gave it some character. And I never really experienced that. Even the diplomacy system is the same kind of way. It's like, all right, so here, once again, it's very functional. It shows me I've got a binding alliance with these guys, I am in a cold war with these guys, and I am at war with these guys. And little smiley faces indicate how happy or sad these guys are with me. I click on them right there, talk to them. You know, it doesn't even bring up a little screen. You remember how Master of Orion did it? Maybe you do, with the little animation that came up. It's just, that gave it a sense of... I'm going to use the word character again, aren't I? I must come up with something better. Personality. That's probably the best way to do it. And here, there just isn't that. The system is really... It's really basic. Like, if I want to... let's say I want to trade some research. I currently have 3 deals with them. Once again, the interface gives me the information I need very, very easily. No problem at all. Let's say I want to trade some research. You know what? These guys aren't very powerful anyway. I'm going to give you all my stuff. You can see the deal approval right there. Ooh, they really don't want to give me optimized logistics, do they? No, they do not. Maybe they'll give me hypermagnets. Nope. Alien barter theory? They... All right, so... That's what they're going to do. If I give them atomic substrates, then I'll be able to get these for. Like, it's not really a good deal for me. I guess I should really check through what these research actually involves. These are actually fairly basic researches. Isotope fragmentation? Yeah. Let's find some high-cost research. Like this one, hypermagnetics. That would be good. Give me hypermagnetics. An alien barter theory. These are expensive. Radiation proofing, perhaps. Do I want anything else? That seems okay. I'm giving them a lot of valuable research to actually get this. But once again, these guys are so small, they're really not a threat to me. So it's just better for me to make that barter. There we go. And it's done. It's like they don't even thank you for it. And you might think, well, that's not important, but I kind of think that it is, because it just feels... Oh, it feels so dry. It feels so clean. Just a little bit too clean. I like my games just being a little bit rough around the edges, because it gives it a sense of style. And sadly, this game doesn't seem to have that. There's another thing that I don't like is missing. The idea of espionage. I mean, that's a fairly common thing in 4X strategy games. Espionage. Okay, that seems cool, right? Well, yeah, it does seem cool, but they don't have any of that. So I can't go spying, I can't go stealing other people's technologies or anything like that. That level of intrigue simply isn't there. I think that pretty much covers, for the most part, what I think about this title. It does have a multiplayer mode as well. Apparently that had a few issues on launch, but it's pretty good now. It also had a problem with cheating. Apparently it was possible to exploit and modify things, and I've also been told that if you get a bad draw on the start, like if you end up on a really bad starting planet, you're kind of boned. Like, you are absolutely gimped for the rest of the game, but you only find out that you're gimped when you come up against an empire that you don't have a chance against. I mean, these guys right here, these guys are probably going to be fighting me pretty hard eventually. They have a larger empire than me, but if I recall correctly, I actually have a better technological level than they do, so I may be able to fight them with superior tech but smaller forces. Also, resource-wise, I have access to this area, which I've completely blocked up, so that might work out. It is possible, by the way, to equip your ships with warp drives that can actually bypass these little lines between the stars, these kind of lanes, so it is possible for them to come over in this direction, but the AIs never really seem to try and do that. I'm very surprised that the Amoeba are right next to that. They could very easily jump in and colonize this entire area, which would make their empire much more powerful, but they don't seem to have any willingness whatsoever to do that. I think maybe you also have to scout the planet, and I don't think they've done that, so that might have something to do with it. They can't get through my territory to actually have a look at it. Aside from that, you can design your own race, which essentially involves you choosing statistics. I'll give you a look at that right now, actually. It'll have auto-saved, so no big deal. Head on back there. These are the green guys. Yeah, the Horatio, they're not messing around. They are not messing around. All right, let's create an empire, shall we? So, Sophons, there we go. I could do a random faction. The thing is that all that does is it just picks one of these randomly, which is not really what I'm after. And if I wanted to, I could have a look at the Amoeba. You'll see like the looks of their ships there. I think that artistically the game looks great, at least in the battle sequences and the planet screens. They look awesome, but the interface kind of lets it down in that regard. Oh yeah, that very much reminds me of a sort of Battlefleet Gothic thing. So I can add an empire, just create them. Now, these will have an affinity, and that's a bunch of different passives, and it will also give you the ship type of that. So if I wanted my stuff to look like the United Empire, great, I can do that, no problem at all. And then I can customize pretty much everything I could possibly desire. You can see that there's advantages and disadvantages there. And then there are just huge numbers of traits. As you can see right there. This is actually another problem I've got with the game, that a lot of these are not very well explained, and that's not such a big deal here, because you can just hover over it, but it is a big deal on the research screen. That's something I haven't shown you, so let me show you that, and I want you to try and make head or tails of this research screen, because it's a bit crazy. You have to be very, very picky with what you take in your research, because you've got these four huge branches over to the side, but a lot of these don't make any sense at all. I mean, it's just a naming scheme. I think it's a lot of technobabble. Self-replicating structures, which unlock smart cargo and dusty sensors. Alright, so then I can look at it under there, but it's not an easy research tree to master. Not at all. I mean, how much do I really need all of this stuff? I really don't know. I don't think I'm ever really equipped with the information that I require in order to make good choices here. It's not a terrible thing. I eventually think that after a number of playthroughs, you will get it. You will understand what's going on here, and you'll understand what the best routes are. And I started off by getting all of the research for colonizing different kinds of planets. That seemed like a good idea to me to be expansionist, but it didn't really work out so well because I expanded too early and too quickly at the start, and I didn't have enough population to actually do anything, so that wasn't exactly great. I also don't really like the fact that none of the research is particularly interesting. Like, this sounds really cool. Dark energy shields, non-baryonic explosives and graviton shielding. What does that give me? Entropy missiles. But as you can see, they're just another kind of missile. They don't really do anything different. This is the final level of missile interception. It's just statistically better. There's no little twist on it. There's no character to it, once again. You remember some of the really cool weapon types in Master of Orion? Like, some would be shield disruptors, there were death rays, there were all kinds of ship-type weapons that were varied and different, and you would pick different weapons depending on the roles that you wanted. Well, here there's really only three kinds of ship weapon, and they upgrade in a very linear way, and that actually very accurately describes pretty much every research tech in this game. Aside from stuff like, say, warp engines that actually make a big difference and give you a new mechanic to play with, a lot of these research types don't give you new mechanics to play with, so the game kind of stagnates after a while into, once again, going back to statistics and spreadsheets. Which is interesting to some people, and to a degree, it's interesting to me, too. I love the fact that at a glance, I can see all of this stuff, and I can very easily run my empire, I can manipulate my tax rate, and I can see the effects immediately. In every possible respect. The game gives you loads of feedback. It helps inform your turn-to-turn decisions, aside from the research, as we've already pointed out. But I don't think it's enough to keep me interested. I think Galsiv did it better. Galsiv had more character. Galsiv had a little bit more going for it. Hopefully this game actually gets some of the features that I was mentioning. They are actively developing this game and adding more features to it, and I know for a lot of people this might actually be really interesting. It certainly was to me. It was enough for me to play 150 turns of a game and restart three times, and I had, for the most part, some fun with it. There was some frustration, but it was okay. I hoped for more, I guess. I really hope that they can improve this game as going forward, because I think this is a really good base for an awesome title. I would love to see a mod for this game for Star Trek, like a Birth of the Federation mod. That would work perfectly. I mean, hell, the battle system is very similar to Birth of the Federation anyway. I would love that. That would be great. And then, of course, you add some character to the game and suddenly things get a little bit more interesting. I want to see an expanded diplomacy system. I would love to see a better system for any kind of espionage. I mean, there's nothing in the game for that at the moment. And maybe some more diverse research that was just a little bit more interesting than getting a couple of extra percent damage on your gun. That, to me, isn't so entertaining. But there you go, folks. That's a look at Endless Space. You may enjoy it. As I say, it's not a bad game. I just think it's got a little way to go in order to get to its potential. It hasn't quite reached that yet. You can find this game on Steam, also available on Gamersgate. Links to buy in the description below this video, if you so desire. My name has been Total Biscuit, taking a look at Endless Space. I'll see you next time.